Now we talk about synchronization hardware, about hardware instructions for synchronization. Before we talk about this, we just indicate that on a uniprocessor system, it is possible to solve the critical section problem by disabling interrupts. Remember that if a process is guaranteed not to get interrupted while working in the critical section, we don't have a problem. So one way of doing that within the kernel, you know, operating systems may just temporarily disable interrupts while in the critical section, then enable them again when a process exits the critical section. But this is feasible only, you know, within the kernel and only on a uniprocessor system. On a multiprocessor system, it's not going to be feasible because you will have to send a message to all processors. So within the kernel and on a uniprocessor system, this may be feasible. Now, modern processors provide synchronization instructions like the test and set instruction. Now, even though this looks like a C function, it's not a C function. This is an actual instruction. Hardware instruction, and these three lines here are not actual code. These are just, this is a conceptual description of this instruction, you know, what this instruction does. This instruction, what it does is that it takes a pointer to an integer, a variable, or a boolean. It takes a pointer to a boolean, and then it first saves the current value of this boolean, then it changes the value of the boolean to true. So it sets it to true. Then it returns RV. And what does RV mean here? What will it have?
The old value.
The old value. So it sets it to true and returns the old value. That's what it does. Now, how can this be used in synchronization? Now, this is real. Now, this is an atomic instruction. So this is a hardware instruction. Right, so you cannot get interrupted in the middle of doing this because it's a hardware instruction. You cannot get interrupted in the middle of one instruction. Remember when we described the critical section problem, we have a critical section problem. If we get interrupted in the middle of making an update that involves multiple instructions, but you cannot get interrupted in the middle of one instruction, because if you get interrupted in the middle of one instruction, you will resume that instruction. So it's, if the instruction doesn't complete, then it doesn't do anything. So it's either completely done or it doesn't do anything. An instruction will not be partially done. Okay, so how can we use this for synchronization? Well, we can use test and set on a lock variable. So lock is a variable that indicates whether the critical section is locked or not. If lock is true, then critical section is locked. If lock is false, then critical section is not locked. And every process is going to do test and set. So it's going to say, okay, set the lock, lock it for me, but tell me if lock was true or false before I set it. If it was true, then it means that another process must have locked it, and it's locked, and I'm going to wait. So waiting is going to depend on the older value of the lock, because the new value will always be true. Test and set will always set the lock to true, right? So this waiting is going to be dependent on the older value. So if you are saying that if another process has locked this before me, then I'm going to wait until the lock becomes false. And when does it become false? When a process is done with its critical section, it's going to release the lock by setting the lock to false. Okay. Now the question is, do we have bounded waiting? Or in other words, can a process access the critical section multiple times in a row while another process is waiting? Can this happen? Can a process access the critical section? Well, let's trace it again. Suppose that there is a process that finds the critical section available and it locks it. While it's in the critical section, another process arrives and finds the lock equal to true, and the other process is here, waiting. So the first process is in the critical section. The second process is here, executing this loop. Remember, in parallel processing, you have multiple processes executing the same code, but each process could be on a different line in that code. So one process is in the critical section, the other process is waiting here in the loop. Now, when the process that is in the critical section is done with the critical section, it's going to set lock to false. Now, of course, if it sets lock to false, the other process that is waiting, if it has the CPU, it's going to detect it. Now, the value of lock will become false, and the other process will enter the critical section. So if scheduling is fair, we don't have a problem. But what if scheduling is not fair? What if the process that is waiting loses the CPU for a long time? And while it doesn't have, while that other process is not on the CPU, the current process unlocks this, then it completes its remainder section, then it executes the next iteration of the loop. Now, when it executes the next iteration of the loop, what will it find the value of lock to be? It will find it false, which means that it can enter the critical section again. So, if scheduling is not fair, if the process that is in the critical section gets enough CPU cycles, it may keep entering the critical section for an unbounded number of times. Unbounded. How many times? We don't know. It depends on how many CPU cycles this is going to get and how many CPU cycles the other process will get. So it depends on the relative speed. But we cannot make any assumption about the relative speed. We cannot assume that they are both going at the same speed. One of them could be going much faster than the other, and we don't know which one would be going faster. So what this means is that this particular solution does not set any bound or any limit on the number of times a process can access the critical section while another process is waiting. So this is exactly what we call starvation. So when waiting is not bounded, a process is starving. Now, starvation is different from a deadlock. So the other process is not deadlocked, it's only starving. So deadlock means waiting forever. As we will see, we'll study deadlock in detail. But starvation doesn't mean waiting forever. It means that there is no limit on the on the number of times that a process is waiting, the number of times that other processes may get the intersection, the critical section while one process is waiting. In practice, starvation means waiting for a long time, but not waiting forever. Okay, there is another instruction, also an atomic instruction, that does the same thing, which is compare and swap. Compare and swap, it takes a value or a pointer to an integer and the expected value and the new value. And it's going to say, okay, first it's going to store the old value. Then it's going to say, if value is equal to the expected value, then I'm going to change it to this new value. Then I'm going to return the old value. And it's very similar. So it's we can use it with a lock variable. We initialize it to zero, which is unlocked. Then we do compare and swap. So we're saying, okay, here's the pointer to the lock. If the expected value is zero, which means if it's unlocked, lock it for me. So 0 is unlocked, 1 is locked. So it's saying that if the expected value is 0, if it's unlocked, then set it to 1, which means lock it for me. Okay, and it does the same thing, like same thing as set and test. Okay. And again, you know, we don't have bounded waiting. So here, waiting is unbounded, which means the process can access the critical section multiple times while the other or other processes are waiting. Okay. Now, we will see how we can fix this, how we can ensure bounded waiting. So here's a way of ensuring bounded waiting with a tested set. So now what's the... So this code looks messy. But let me see if I can explain the idea here. Before I explain the idea, you know, what was the, you know, intuitively, in the Peterson solution, we had a way of ensuring or satisfying the bounded waiting condition. But in the test and set solution, the bounded waiting was not satisfied. So what's the difference? What's that thing that we had in the Peterson solution to ensure bounded waiting that we don't have here?
Peterson solution would let program yield to the other program.
Mm-hmm. So we had that turn. We had that turn, and each process was yielding to the other process. So it's yielding. So here, you know, the process can be selfish. There is no mechanism for a process to yield to another process. So when it's done with a critical section, it's not going to check if anyone is waiting. It's going to take it again and again and again if it's getting enough CPU cycles. It can keep getting that critical section for an unlimited number of times. Now, in order to solve this problem, we will make processes unselfish. We will make the processes more considerate of other processes. So when a process is done with a critical section here, when it's done with a critical section, it's not going to go and grab it again if it's getting enough CPU cycles. It's going to check on other processes to see if any of them is waiting. If it finds a waiting process, then it's going to give it the critical section. Okay? So the key idea is, after a process is done with the critical section, it will not act selfishly and take it again if it's getting more CPU cycles than other processes. No, it's going to check. And if it finds another process that is waiting, at least one other process that is waiting, then it's going to give it the critical section. Now, if it doesn't find any other process that is waiting, then it will feel free to take the critical section again. So it will take it only if no other process is waiting. Now, how is this implemented? Well, it's implemented using two variables. So there is the waiting array. So for each process, there is a waiting flag indicating whether that process is waiting or not. And this is the flag that will be used by the process that has just exited the critical section to check on other processes if they are waiting or not. So it's going to check on the waiting flag to see if other processes are waiting or not. And we have the key, which is the value returned by test and set, which is the older value of the lock. So basically, if a process, you know, if the older value is locked, and the current process is waiting, so each process will set its own waiting to true first. It's going to say, I am waiting, and I'm going to check on the key. And if key is locked, so it will be doing test and set. If key is true, and I am waiting, then I'm going to keep waiting. So clearly here, waiting is, if waiting is true, and key is true, so this process will be in an infinite loop, right? If we are setting key to true and waiting to true, So if none of these values, if none of them changes, we will be in an infinite loop. But we will not be in an infinite loop. Why?
Because it's not the only one that has access to key.
Yeah, exactly. Because other processes may be changing key and waiting, right? In fact, the way a process will be giving the critical section to a process that has been waiting is by setting waiting for that other process to false, as we will see. Okay. So now what's the purpose of setting the key to true here before we enter the loop? What if we delete this line? What will happen?
And it won't yield to the other processes?
Well,
while key.
Okay, so if key is not true, then the value of key could be false. Mm-hmm. And if the value of key happens to be false, then we will not execute the loop at all. So we'll just break, we will check the condition once, and we will not execute the loop, which means that we will not do test and set at all. So we can get the same thing by doing a do while instead of a while. So if we do a do while, so what setting key to true here does is that ensuring that we do test and set at least once. Because you don't want to enter the critical section without testing. So to avoid entering the critical section without testing at all. Okay. So now after a process is done with the critical section, it's going to say, okay, I'm going to check on other processes. So how does this work? So if, let's say, N equals 5. So we have processes 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And let's say that I equals 2. So this is I. Let's say that this is I. And process I has just exited the critical section. Now I is done with the critical section. So what it will be doing is, it's going to check on these processes, 3, 4, 0, 1, in this order. So it's going to go in this order. See if any of them is waiting. So maybe this is false, not waiting. This is true, waiting. This is false, this is true. So it's going to check in this order. So are you waiting? No. Okay, so nothing will happen. Are you waiting? Yes. Then it's going to give the critical section to this. Right. But what if this is false? Then it will keep checking. So this is false again. This is true. Then it will give the critical section to this. So it will give the critical section to the first true that it will find in this cycle. Okay? What if all of them are false? Then it will go through the whole cycle and nobody's waiting. So it will feel free to take the critical section again if nobody's waiting. Okay? So this is the idea. So this is why we start with J is the variable that will go, that will check on other processes in this cycle. So J initially equals I plus 1. So we will first check on I plus 1, and then we will increment. So that's why J initially equals I plus 1. Of course, mod n, because we're doing this in a circular manner. So if this is I, if I was this, then I plus 1 mod n is going to be this, right? So this is going to be the next process to check on. So while I is not equal to J and not waiting, so we will exit the loop if another process is waiting or if J equals I. Now what does J equal I here mean? What does J equal I mean? If at the end of the loop, J equals I, what does this mean?
It means everyone is false.
It means what?
Every other process.
Yeah, all of them are false. Because you're starting J from here, and you go through all of these, all of them are false, and you end up here. So J equals I is nobody's waiting. OK? Okay. So if nobody's waiting, all what this process will do is setting the lock to false so that it can grab it again if it needs it. If not, if I is not equal to J, then someone is waiting. So it will take that J, the first J that it found, waiting, it will make its for its waiting flag, it will set it to false. Now, when it sets its flag to false, now the process that is currently checking on other processes if they're waiting or not, is gonna check the waiting for another process to false. Now, where will that other process be at that point? Where will process J be?
First while loop?
Yeah, it will be in the while loop. Wait, what does waiting mean? Waiting means you are in this loop. You are checking on test and set. Okay? So waiting means that a process is in this loop, stuck in this loop. So the I that is doing the checking is here, while the J that will be given access to the critical section will be here, and it will break out of the loop because its own waiting is going to become now false. So this means that, okay, so it's like saying UJ, you no longer have to wait. So J is going to, the waiting for J is going to become false, and then J will break out of the loop and access the critical section. So that's how a process gives access to the critical section to another process. Okay, any questions on this?